speaking, I'm like, who's he talking about? Of course, to the pastor, shepherd of the house, officers and members, to my teacher, Dr. Muhammad, to my mama's friend, Ms. Clark, and to my father's friend, Siggy. My mother was a student of Dr. Alexander. I have actually in my possession one of the original copies of How I Rose You Would. And my mother cherished that to the day that she passed. And I was blessed that my Saturdays were spent in the presence of my father, Siggy, and other men who would spend all Saturday morning listening to jazz and pontificating on the best way to improve black people's lives.
Wow.
That was the legacy that was given to me. The legacy from Dr. Muhammad, who took the legacy from Dr. Alexander. That's the reason why I married the woman that I married.
All right.
You got to understand, I would be remiss if we didn't mention our dear sister, Dorothy Stewart, who has made her transition, and those many, many women who were part of the movement of Jackson. And so I just want to talk a little bit today, and in about 15 minutes, my wife is going to raise her hand. She's going to say, shut up and sit down. And I'm going to shut up and sit down, because that's what I've been doing for 20-some years. The topic of my discussion is Margaret Walker Alexander, a whole person. Margaret Walker Alexander was a whole person. Her life wasn't crafted around her artistry. Her artistry flowed from her life. Her poem, Jackson State, May 15, 1970, about the moment when the Jackson Police Department, the Mississippi Highway Patrol, and the Mississippi National Guard surrounded Jackson State College and fired over 400 shots into Alexander Hall, killing two students and wounding 14 others, is a testament to her desire to use her art to illuminate the struggle and beauty. But Margaret Walker understood that our beauty was our courage, our wisdom, and our dedication. This is what made clear in her early life with her poem, I Want to Write, and she states, I want to write the songs of my people. I want to hear them singing melodies in the dark. I want to catch the last floating strands from their sub-torn throats. I want to frame their dreams into words, their souls into notes. I want to catch their sunshine laughter in a bowl, fling dark hands into a darker sky and fill them full of stars, then crush and mix such lights till they become myriad pools of brilliance in the dawn. Was Margaret's love letter to y'all. Her desire to write for and about African Americans was driven by her desire to destroy the myth of African peoples as a monolith and to expose to the world the multiple brilliant stars that compose the body of African peoples in the same way in which 1 Thessalonians 5:23-24 teaches that all people are combined of three parts, spirit, soul, and body, and in each part must be acknowledged, protected, and nurtured. This understanding of the human being created in Margaret Walker Alexander a writing, a depth, a rich, and a diversity of her aesthetic balance and style. Aesthetics is a fancy word for how she wrote, y'all know that. The genres in which she wrote. She wrote in all types of genres. She wasn't just a poet. She wasn't just a novelist. She wasn't just an essayist. Her brilliance, the subject matter that all reflected her desire to find multiple ways to express who she was as a whole person, a mother, a wife, a neighbor, a church member, a professor, an institution builder, a mentor, and an activist, which reflects the multidimensionality of what it means to be African-American and what it means to be fully human. to be one who believes that being a child of God means to be dedicated fully to learning each aspect of oneself, which allows one to impregnate each life that one meets with the fullness of love. See, half people can't give you no whole results.
Right.
So the reason we got whole results is because Margaret understood her whole self. And yet, sadly, this is as much her limitation to others as it is an asset, because she, in wanting to be and live a holistic life, she became too much, too nuanced, too complex to be boxed neatly into one other's earthly definable identity. She was considered too Christian to be a revolutionary, too radical to be submissive, too academic to be cafe, too juke joint to be ivory tower, too meek to be feminist, and too mighty to be a helpmate, and too bold to be in the background. Wow. Often, see, when the world doesn't know what to do with you, doesn't know how to label you, then they just ignore and marginalize you. That's why Nikki Giovanni stated that Margaret Walker is the most famous person nobody knows. How could this be? How can somebody be the most famous person nobody knows? Simply, Dr. Alexander, by writing what she wrote and how she wrote it, along with establishing one of the first centers to study black life in America. Let me tell it again. Establishing one of the first centers to study black life in America. She was so far ahead of her time that the people of her time could benefit from what she was doing, even when they couldn't quite fully grasp the manner in which she did it.
Yep.
Dr. Alexander was more intellectual, more professional, and more courageous than most of the men with whom she worked, and then she was still able to prepare hot meals for her husband and her children while writing the first and most important neo-slave narrative, Jubilee. After having already become the first African-American woman to win the National Poetry Prize and Yale Young Award for her collection poetry of For My People, she wouldn't even get started. That's just too much woman. That's just too much human being.
All right, yeah.
See, being a mother, a wife, a scholar, an activist, a professor, an institution builder, some call that doing too much, but I call it understanding that God creates each one of us as complex beings with multiple purposes. Yes. See, each one of us is simply a pie chart with many slices. That's being called a whole person. And the only person who has trouble or problems understanding a whole person is someone with a limited understanding of what it means to be human. Right. Someone stuck on one slice of oneself. Right. See, other writers may be more celebrated than Dr. Alexander, but none of them have crafted literature that speaks to and celebrates as many aspects of the black community that Dr. Alexander has. Jubilee, For My People, and Prophet for a New Day address every facet of what it means to be African American. Years before the Black Lives Matter and the Me Too movement, Dr. Alexander was writing poems, stories, essays, and erecting a black studies center that all affirmed the value of black and female lives. I told you this woman was before her time.
All right. All right.
Had we begun listening to Dr. Alexander 72 years ago, maybe by now we would have embraced the teachings of Jesus in a manner that would enable us to reduce greatly, if not eradicate, economic exploitation, sexual harassment and assault, police brutality, and other acts in which man dominates man to his injury, as forbidden by Ecclesiastes 8 and 9. So I'm just going to give you three brief snippets of three works by Dr. Alexander that show you that in studying to be all of who she was forcing and challenging us to be all of who we are. In the way that Thessalonians said, we must understand that we are a spirit with a soul living temporarily in a physical body. So first we get Jubilee. And in Jubilee we get Vira, right? Vira is a wife, a mother, and a businesswoman, which allows us to see women as whole people. See, sexism derives from the inability of men to see women as whole beings. 1 Peter 3 and 7 teaches that God will not answer the prayers of a man who mistreats his wife. So We must learn, us men, to see women as more than just our trophies and objects, and to see them as they were designed by Jehovah, as an equal heir to the throne.
That's right.
As 1 Peter 3 and 7 also teaches us. Thus, characters such as Violet can teach both men and women the power that women have to enable humanity to become all that Jehovah designs us to be.
Come on, brother.
So they deal with Violet as a wife. What I like about Violet the wife was, and this is something we need to tell young girls, Violet was not interested in any man who couldn't take her where she needed to be. Brandon Ware strolled on the plantation. Free man, free suit, free attitude. Violet said, he don't really look like much of nothing. Spitting his slick game. Going in one ear and out the other. It wasn't until Virus said, oh, you free. Okay. I can work with that. See, because only a free man can help you have free babies. Yeah. Only a progressive man can help you have progressive children. So Virus understood what too many women have forgotten. That in order for men to reach a certain standard, women have to hold that standard to a certain level. I'm amazed that women forget. Everything men do is to get the attention of a woman. I don't understand how we've lost that. Men cut down trees, drain rivers, plow fields, build businesses, simply to get the attention.
Yeah, you're right.
Fire understood her power. And said, oh, okay. This what you want? Yeah. Well, you're going to have to show me some liberation, brother. Yeah. And when you can't show me no liberation, then I'm going to have to go to a man that's going to show me some liberation. So Fire understood, right? What did the Bible tell us? When a man finds what? Why he finds what? Says when he finds a wife, not a side piece. Not a one night. Not a jump off. When he finds a holistic being invested in kingdom building through her position as a woman. That's a wife.
Yes, sir.
Then, Viren as a mother. Real simple. Viren had a plan to escape. Plan was working, was gone. But she could not escape with her children. So what did Viren decide to do? Stay enslaved. That's the only lesson in parenting you need to have, right? Those of us who are putting everything else before our children, that's why our communities and our children are dysfunctional as they are now. Viren didn't understand being free with her children being in bondage. So if you want to understand the lesson that Margaret Walker Alexander is trying to tell us, is that if you choose to have children, if you choose to, you don't have to choose to have them. But if you choose to have them, then you have the responsibility to do for your children what Christ has done for the body of the church. Why did it take Dr. Alexander as brilliant as she was 30 years to finish Jubilee? Because while she was writing Jubilee, she was also a faithful mother and a faithful wife to her husband and her children, doing what she thought God needed her to be, which didn't make any sense to build up a professional career, but she couldn't build up a successful family. And then finally, Viren as the businesswoman. We never talk about that. We never talk about Jubilee and Viren being a business. And her husband, Ennis, had the nerve, because, you know, us men, you do what I say. Ennis, I forbids you. Not going to take you out there and sell your eggs and your greens. She looked Ennis and I about her and said, man, we need every cent we can get. And what you're bringing in ain't enough cents. And then when Ennis refused to take it, what did she do? She got up on the mule, hitched up the wagon. That's the problem right there. A woman know how to hitch up a wagon. That's the problem. Because if it was all driver, she can't go. That's how we think it's men. Clear, yeah, please. Yeah. They don't know how to hitch up no wagon. But why was he determined when Ennis wanted to build a new house? What did Byra say? She said, no, it's not financially time. Because we haven't put away enough money for the education of our children. Byra understood what so many of us have forgotten, the importance of self-ownership, the importance of owning our own businesses, right? See, we've confused integration and desegregation. And by confusing integration and desegregation, we don't have any businesses that allow us to educate our children in the way that Viola wanted her children to be educated. Everybody understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So if we truly want to be like Viola, then the first thing we have to do is be like Viola, not only create our own businesses, but then to support our own. The apex of what Jehovah wants us. See, I'm like y'all, I'm old enough to when black people used to have to search magazines and TV to see ourselves. Right, I'm old enough to where we got happy when you saw one black person in a commercial. My grandmama actually once changed where she banked because the company had a black person in their commercial. I'm like, grandma, I don't really think that's, you should be making your financial decisions on that, but I understood. Because to my grandmother, at least that commercial was saying, I see your humanity. So if you want to understand the beauty of For My People, Margaret Walker is saying, I see your humanity. The problem is, today we don't see our humanity, right? Church people don't see the humanity of cafe people. Cafe people don't see the humanity of church people. Country people don't see the humanity of city people. City people don't see the humanity of, yet we all call ourselves children of God. So she didn't say, Paul is not for some of my people. For a few of my people, what's the title of the poem? For my people. And my means all of my people. Then finally, I want to go to Prophets for a New Day. What I love about Prophets for a New Day is that it continues the celebration, not only the complexity of black people, but the complexity of black leadership. Let's deal with Central for a moment. One of the most beautiful and powerful things about Central is that it remains in the community connected to all of the people in the community.
Yeah.
Right? When I walk into Central, I never get the notion that only some of the people are welcome in Central. Doesn't matter your degree, doesn't matter your job, doesn't matter your status. As kingdom builders, you are living in the mission of Margaret Walker Alexander, that you are here not for some of the people, but for. And that is what she gives us in Prophets for a New Day. She gives us Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, and Medgar Evers. And the question is, why does she give us all three of those type of leaders? For the same reason the gospel, the Bible gives us four gospels. Think about the Gospels, right? It's all about one dude, right? Why do you need one book or four different books about one? Well, think about how they structure. They're structured differently because we understand not every book is going to reach every person. Matthew was a teacher. So what kind of genius did you get in there? You get the teacher. Luke was a doctor. You get the scholarly work. Everybody understand?
Yeah.
So Margaret Walker understood that Malcolm had as much significance as Medgar, and Medgar had as much significance as Martin. Because it takes all of us to really do this kingdom building work. And the problem is, coming back before my people, if you can't see the humanity in yourself, right? Then you are unable to see the humanity in other
people.
In the poem for Malcolm, she celebrates Malcolm like the prophet who is needed to tell us the things we don't want to hear, but must know to become better people. Y'all know Malcolm could be hard ones. See, people talk about Malcolm X hard on white folks. No, he wasn't just hard on white folks. Let's be real clear. And a lot of black folks didn't like him. And why? Because what we say is true what? True hurt. Right? Well, think about Isaiah. Right? Did you think the people always like Isaiah? Read some of that. I know Isaiah would be teaching, preaching. If somebody back to him, Isaiah, man, he need to go head on. He ain't got to do all that. See, Malcolm understood in the great tradition of the great prophets that sometimes people have to be agitated out of their comfort zone.
Come on,
right? If I don't know what's wrong with me, see, I can't get healed if I ever want to admit that I'm sick. But I can't admit that I'm sick if I don't understand the reality of who I am. Right? What they say when Jesus was in the cafe, the judge joint, hey, what you doing? What are you doing up here? With these people. The fact that we don't teach Jesus, it was just beautiful what Jesus said. Jesus said, you know, I didn't come here for the whale.
That's right.
Jesus said, I didn't come here for the whale. If you wear, what you worried about me opening the cafe for? If you wear, but these people in here need me. They sick, I'm the healing medicine. Malcolm was trying to tell us we were sick. We were sick with the white supremacy of self-hatred. Right? And when you sick with the white supremacy of self-hatred, you can't ever do what's in your own. She says, quote, beautiful were your sandpaper words against our skin. Your blood and water pour from your flowing wounds. You have cut open our breasts and dug scalpels into our brain. That's what he did.
Yes.
So the next time Pastor McCoy up here and he's speaking, you feel it all funny.
Help me.
Well, don't be mad at him. And don't get mad at the Holy Spirit either. Examine why you mad. And if you examine why you mad, you won't know because your life is not in line with the word of Jehovah. Two more points and I'm gonna close. In Amos, in the poem Amos, Martin Luther King is depicted as the prophet Amos, who tries to warn the wicked oppressors of the consequences of their actions, showing that racism or white supremacy isn't just a legal wrong, but is a sin against humanity that will continue to limit the growth of humans until this dysfunction of racial hate is erased. So we have to understand the work that King was doing was righteous work.
That's right.
What does she say? She says that Amos is a shepherd of suffering sheep, a pastor preaching in the depths of Alabama, preaching social justice to the South End, preaching to the poor a new gospel of love. With the words of a God and the dreams of a man, Amos is our loving shepherd. Preaching to the persecuted and the disinherited, music, preaching love and justice to the solid southern land. Amos is a prophet with a vision of brotherly love. That's King, ain't it? And it tells you the death and the unrighteousness of this nation that they would kill a man like that.
Mercy.
Are we surprised?
No.
They killed Yeshua, right?
That's right.
We know who Yeshua is.
Yeah.
That's right. Jesus. They killed Jesus. If you can kill Jesus, you can definitely kill Martin. You can definitely kill maybe. Why? Because your life is not aligned to the will of Jehovah. And finally, in the poem Michael, Megan Evers is depicted as a visionary prophet who is before his time. Right? Megan used to love to say, you can kill a man, but you can't kill an idea. We're going to get rid of this Jesus. Mm-hmm. Get rid of this cat. He's taking money out of the plate. He's turning the people against us. We're going to put him in the ground. We're going to not only put him in the ground, we're going to put a big boulder.
Yes, sir.
Next resurrection day, I want y'all to think about something.
So think about something that was recommended. Think about how his mama then went down there to go get it. Yes, right. Because that's something I never thought about. Do you know they never contemplated how we gonna move that over? Think about that. Let's be honest. Half of us in here, we ain't going down there. Well, we can't move the boat. Ain't no sense going down there.
Here you
go. What did Mary do? And when you worry about that boat. Because when you're doing the work of Jehovah, Boulder wasn't even there. But see, that's what Margaret is trying to tell us. She's highlighting these men because she's saying, when you are walking in the righteousness of Jehovah, no weapon formed against you. See, what we have forgotten, African people, that's right, I'm gonna call you what you are, African people. What we have forgotten is that our true mission that Dr. Alexander kept calling us to was the mission of love.
That's it.
And the mission of salvation.
That's it.
So you can't be for exploitation. You can't keep a job where you know they want you to do something wrong just because you want to pay your life bill. Because if you truly believe in Jehovah, you understand that your life bill is going to be paid because you did righteous work.
Right.
So Mecca, Martin, Malcolm, the prophets of a new day never worried about that. What does Matthew tell us? Look at the birds in the sky.
There you go.
A bird in the sky never worries about what he's going to eat. And if our master will take care of the birds in the sky, he will certainly take care of it. So in closing, when you remember Margaret Walker Alexander, remember her message of love, and remember her message that we are all children. No matter our faces, no matter our class, no matter our backgrounds, and if you have the love of Jesus in you, you will be able to see the love of Jesus in others. I thank God for that.